إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Last week we were talking about the issue of Qadr. Last week we mentioned most of the issues concerning the belief in Al-Qadr. And the week before that we mentioned all of the issues, or majority of the issues concerning the belief in Allah Jalla Jalala. And these two, belief in Allah and the belief in Al-Qadr, are the most important or the biggest of the topics to do with belief in and of themselves. So they're the biggest issues, and they're the issues in which a lot of the difference of opinion occurred. So with regards to Qadr, we said Qadr has four stations of belief. What were the four stations of belief, or four levels of belief in Qadr? What were they? Al-ilm, knowledge, that Allah has knowledge over all things.
The writing,
Al-Kitaba, that Allah wrote all things. The Mashi'ah, the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. Whatever Allah wills will happen. Whatever He doesn't will not happen. And the last one was? The bringing of all of that into existence, the khalq, the creation. The culmination of those three is the khalq, is the creation. And the creation comes into existence how? Allah knew it was going to come into existence, how He wrote it, and how He willed it, Jalla wa Ala. We mentioned the belief of Ahl Sunnah with regards to Al-Qadr. And we went in through depth with regards to Al-Qadr. And we spoke about that the person lives in Qadr. His whole life is living within Qadr. Whatever happens to the person is the Qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal. Before it happens, the person has the choice. He can choose many different paths to take. He has total free will over what he chooses, or what she chooses. But once the action is taken and the path is chosen, then that path is the Qadr of Allah, whatever it may be. When the action occurs, then it becomes the Qadr of Allah. Before that, it has many possibilities. But when the person chooses one of those possibilities, then that is the Qadr of Allah. And we mentioned the statement of Umar radiallahu anhu, when he went to Damascus, and he didn't enter Damascus. What was the reason he didn't enter Damascus? It's all recap. Huh? It was a plague. Ta'un. Many of the Sahaba were killed in this ta'un. It's called ta'un al-amwas. It took the lives of many of the companions, radiallahu anhu. So he didn't enter because of the ta'un. And so the companions differed. What should we do? Should he enter or should he not enter? And so one of them said, if it's the Qadr of Allah, then you'll get ta'un whether you enter or whether you don't. And Umar said back, we run from the Qadr of Allah to the Qadr of Allah. Because whatever you choose becomes the Qadr of Allah. This was the belief of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, what we mentioned. In opposition, of course, there are oppositions to this belief. And the two major oppositions are named in general terms Al-Qadariyah and Al-Jabriyah. They're two opposites. You have Ahl-Sunnah is always in the middle. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. We've made you a nation which is in the middle path, between every Nation, you are in the middle. You don't go to any extremes. And within the groups of Islam, Ahl Sunnah is in the middle, not going to any extreme. So on one extreme we have Al-Qadariya, and on the other extreme we have Al-Jabriya. And Al-Qadariya, they are the deniers of Qadr. They deny the Qadr of Allah Azza wa Jal. We had the Qadariya Al-Ula, we mentioned them before. They denied that Allah has knowledge. He didn't know anything until it happens. He doesn't know anything until it happens. They were the first Qadariya. They existed in the time of the companions of Radiallahu Anhu. The first hadith of Sahih Muslim, where two tabi'een come from Basra, come from Iraq, town of Basra from Iraq, to Mecca to speak to one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ regarding this issue of Qadr. So they come and they go to Masjid al-Haram and they meet Ibn Umar making tawaf. So one comes from one side and the other one comes from the other side. So they come round Ibn Umar. And they know it's Ibn Umar. And they said, "Oh, the son of Umar. Yeah, Ibn Umar. There are people in Basra who are saying things happen without the knowledge of Allah. In al-amru unufan. Things happen, they occur without Allah willing, without Allah knowing them to occur. They just occur." So Ibn Umar said to them, "If you go back, tell those people that I am free of them and they are free of me. They have nothing to do with this deed." And then he mentions the hadith of Jibreel. Where it talks about belief in Qadr. The whole of the hadith of Jibreel, Ibn Umar mentions it on the authority of Umar that he heard his father say, for this one issue, Qadr. You know, the long hadith. What is Islam? What is Iman? What is Ihsan? What are the signs of the Day of Judgment? He narrates this whole hadith for one part of it, the belief in Qadr. To show that the one who doesn't believe in Qadr is not from the believers, is not from the Muslims, is outside the fold of Islam. So the first hadith of Sahih Muslim is to talk about this issue of Qadr. And that it occurred, this belief, or the belief of the Qadariya, occurred while the Sahaba was still alive. The Sahaba was still there. We still had Ibn Umar. We still had Ibn Zubayr. We still had Abu Huraira. We still had Ibn Abbas. And these beliefs started to creep in to the Muslims, especially from the Furs. The Furs were the Persians. During the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, Allah opened up the lands and the Muslims conquered Persia and they conquered the Roman Empire in Sham. So people from the Furs entered into Islam, and with that they brought some of their beliefs, and so the Muslims learnt new things, and some of these beliefs crept into their deen. And so people started to say,
what's Furs?
The Furs, the Persians. The Furs, they are the Persians. So people started to adopt certain beliefs from them. These were the Qadariya al-Ula. Then they watered it down. The Mu'tazila, who are the new Qadariya, even though they're a very old group, Al-Mu'tazila, they watered it down slightly. They said, no, Allah knows. Allah knows, but Allah has no control over what happens. He knows what will happen. He knows it before it happens. But the slave causes it to happen. He creates his own actions. And Allah has no control over it. So they negated Allah's Mashiach. and they negated the khalq. They said there is a creator with Allah. And they made the slave, they made us creators with Allah. Because they said we create our own actions. And Allah has no control over these actions. Allah doesn't want disbelief, according to them. He doesn't want it even qadaran. But it occurs and Allah has no control over it. He doesn't want stealing and all the things that are bad. He doesn't want them to occur, but they occur without Allah's control. تَعَالَ اللَّهُ عُلُوًا كَبِيرًا. How far is Allah from such things? How far is Allah from they occurring in His kingdom, in His dominion, something that He doesn't want? And He doesn't have control over. So these were the Qadariyya, the Mu'tazila, Al-Qadariyya. On the other extreme, we had Al-Jabriyya. Al-Jabriyya said, everything occurs according to the will of Allah, and man has no choice. Man has no choice. He is like the feather in the wind. Wherever it blows, he goes. He has no power over anything. And the most extreme of them are the Jahmiyyah. The most extreme of them are the Jahmiyyah, who totally denied that man had any will or any choice at all or any power over any action. Less than them were the Asha'ira. They said, man has a will and Allah has a will, but Allah's will is dominant. Allah's will is dominant, and man's will doesn't really exist. Man, all he does is he gets put in a place and actions occur, and then he is charged for those actions. So for example, somebody's going to steal. Yes, somebody goes out to steal. The person himself doesn't have the power to steal. This stealing occurs according to the will of Allah. And the one who does the action is Allah, and not the person. But the man is charged for that action. And they called it kasb. They called it kasb. Kasb in Arabic is earning. You earn something. Kasb. They said the actions of man are kasb. They earn it. But they don't actually do anything. They don't actually do anything, they earn the action. And then Allah punishes them or rewards them for something they didn't actually do. This is a belief. You see, we had one extreme, that Allah has no control. Man can do whatever he wants. Allah cannot stop him. Then you have the other extreme, that Allah does everything. Man does nothing, but man is going to be rewarded or punished. These are the extremes. And Ahlul Sunnah is in the middle. Man has free will, but his will is connected to Allah's will. Man does the action. He is the one who chooses the action, and he does it himself. But because he is a creation of Allah, and his actions are an extension of himself, so his actions are creations of Allah. But he is the one who did it. And therefore he is the one that is punished or rewarded for it. Right in the middle, between the two extremes. So the Asha'ira, they gave man a will. But the will is useless. It has no effect. He has a will, he wants to do things. But he can't. Allah's will is dominant upon him. So it has no effect in reality. So again, he becomes the feather in the wind. And Allah is the one who does the actions. تَعَالَ اللَّهُ عُلُوًا كَبِيرًا. Allah doesn't do these actions. The Maturidiyya, as we mentioned, are very close to the Ash'ariyya. But on this issue, they agreed with the Ash'ariyya and they agreed with the Mu'tazila at the same time, which is difficult. They agreed with the Ash'ariyya and the Mu'tazila, even though they are extremes. They said that man has a will. Has a will, and but his will is connected to Allah's will. He has a will, his will is connected to Allah's will. And when he does the action, his will becomes dominant, even though there is Allah's will. His will becomes dominant, even though there is Allah's will. So in that way, they went closer to the Mu'tazila than they went to the Ash'ariyya. And if you didn't understand any of that, it doesn't matter. These are opinions of people. These are opinions of people. And they're against what is in the Qur'an and the Sunnah. But just to make you aware that they exist. These opinions exist even till today. Even till today they exist. And the most prevalent of them is the opinion of Al-Shayr. The most prevalent of them, which is taught in the different Muslim lands, is the opinion of the Ash'ariyya. And some of the poets have written that from the things that are uncomprehensible, from the belief issues which are uncomprehensible, that no one can understand, is the belief of kasb, according to the Ash'ariyya. How can somebody earn an action when they didn't actually do it? And how can somebody be rewarded and punished for something they didn't do? This is un-understand, you can't comprehend it. It's from those amazing, astonishing things that men have come up with. But it became a dominant belief. Okay. So ignore everything I said. In Sahih Muslim and Sahih Bukhari, I should say Bukhari first, Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ mentions an incident that occurred between Musa and Adam, an argument that occurred between Musa and Adam. Musa said to Adam, blamed Adam, and said, "O Adam, it's because of your sin that we were taken out of Jannah." He said, "O Adam, it's because of your sin that we were removed from Jannah." Adam replied to Musa, "O Musa, how can you blame me for something that Allah had written upon me before I was created by 500,000 years?" And the Prophet ﷺ said, Adam won the argument. Adam won the argument. Okay, did we understand it? The argument between Musa and Adam alayhi salam. Musa is blaming Adam. Oh Adam. Adam being the father of all of Bani Adam. It's because of you, because of what you did, we were thrown out of Jannah. If you didn't do it, we would be in Jannah. Okay. Because of what you did, we are thrown out of Jannah. So Adam responded, "O Musa, do you blame me for something that Allah had decreed upon me before I was created by 500,000 years?" And then the Prophet ﷺ said, Adam won the argument. Adam won the argument, not Musa. Musa lost the argument. Adam won the argument. Okay. How do we understand this? We understand this, that Musa alayhi salam was not blaming Adam for what he did. He is blaming Adam for what happened after what he did. Yes? Because of your action, we were thrown out of Jannah. So he's blaming Adam for the musibah, the problem that occurred after his action, not for his action. That's why Adam said, our leaving Jannah had already been written, that this would occur. This was the decree of Allah. That's why Adam won the argument. It's allowable for somebody to blame somebody for a musibah, for a problem that occurs due to a sin they have committed. It's allowed to be blamed or blame. Somebody can, the problem that is a result of somebody's bad action, but not to blame the action itself. It's allowable to do that. And this is the proof that Adam alayhi salam was being blamed for the musibah, but not for the action. And when somebody repents, what happens when somebody repents from a sin? What happens when somebody repents from a sin?
The end forgiveness and the
forgiveness. Allah forgives the sin. So what happened to that sin now? It's gone. It's wiped out. So you cannot blame him for that action anymore, because it no longer exists. Allah has forgiven him, inshallah. But you can blame him for the result of that sin. The results that made the bad consequences of that sin. Do we understand the difference? Blaming from the sin and blaming for the consequences of the sin that occur. Okay. Any questions on Qadr? That was the last issue to do with Qadr that we were going to mention. Any questions on Qadr? No? Qadr is simple? Alhamdulillah, Qadr is simple.
Shaykh, some people used to say, innama al-amal bi niyat.
Yes.
He hasn't done action and he was pretending that Allah has rewarded him.
Again?
Like, he was about to give sadaqah, and when he take his phone out, there's no money in. So we have to go to cash machine.
Allah rewards for the intention, yes.
Okay.
Even if the action doesn't occur. Allah will reward for the intention, even if the action hasn't occurred. Then, moving on, the Shaykh is going to move on to the Imam moves on to a new topic. And the topic is belief in the Prophets and belief in the Messengers. He says, Al-Ba'ithu al-Rusul ilayhim li-iqamat al-Hujjati alayhim. It's talking about Allah, He sent the messengers to them, to mankind, to establish the proof against them. This is the purpose why He sent, Allah Ta'ala sent the messengers. To establish the proof. So that there would be no excuse for humanity or for jinn. After Allah has sent the messengers. Mubashirin wa mundhirin. لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ. That Allah sent them, giving glad tidings and warning, so that there would be no excuse, they would have no proof against Allah after the messengers had been sent. This is what Allah says. This was the purpose of Allah sending the messengers. Allah Ta'ala, when He created Adam, you know in the famous hadith, when He created Adam, He wiped upon the back of Adam and took out all of the creation, all of the children of Adam until the Day of Judgment. And they all stood before Him. We stood before Allah Azza wa Jal with all the rest of humanity. And He made them testify to La ilaha illallah. And we testified to La ilaha illallah, all of us, all of humanity. But He didn't leave that and say that that was sufficient as a proof against us. No. He sent us these prophets and these books so that we would have no excuse in front of Allah. So we would have no excuse in front of Allah that we didn't receive the message. And this is from the greatest ni'mas of Allah Azza wa Jalla upon us, that He guided us. He sent to us those who would tell us what Allah wants from us. And we know that to every nation Allah sent a messenger. We know that, yes? Allah didn't leave any nation without a messenger. Anybody can give me the proof? A proof?
What do we mean by nation?
Every people, all over the world, Allah sent to them a messenger. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةِ الرَّسُولِ أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهُ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. To every nation we sent messengers, or a messenger, telling them, calling them to worship Allah alone, and to avoid everything which is worshipped other than Allah. الطاغوت is everything that is worshipped, or followed, or obeyed, other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. So to every people Allah sent a messenger, no matter where they were, no matter who they were, no matter what time period they were in, Allah sent to them a messenger. That doesn't mean that we know every nation and their messenger. Okay? There are nations that we know of, and we know the prophets and messengers that were sent to them. But there are nations that we don't know that existed. To them Allah sent a messenger, but we don't know the nation, and we don't know the messenger that was sent to them. Like in the famous narration of Bukhari, that the prophets and the messengers will come on the Day of Judgment, and there will be some prophets, there will be some messengers would have many people with them, and there will be some messengers who have few people with them, and there will be messengers who will have one person with them, and there will be a messenger who will come by himself. No one would have believed in him. But the Prophet ﷺ never gave us a number of how many messengers or how many prophets there are. But we know from this verse there are more than what we know of. There are more than what we know of to every nation. Every single nation that came on this earth, Allah sent to them a messenger with the same call, the call to Tawheed and to warn them against shirk, yes.
So does that mean, you know, there was an argument that there are lost tribes, I don't know, in the Amazon somewhere, have never been exposed to other people?
Lost tribes now?
Now, I mean, in the Amazon forest, there are tribes that are not exposed to the outside world. Would they have had messengers as well?
In the past, they would have had messengers. In the past, before our Prophet ﷺ, they would have had a messenger. But we don't know of them. We don't know who the messengers were to them. However, now, the existence after the time of Prophet ﷺ, their messenger is our messenger ﷺ. He was sent to kafatan linnas, to all of mankind, and to the jinn. So their messenger, those who exist now or during from the time of the Prophet ﷺ, then their messenger is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If they don't hear about the Prophet ﷺ, which could happen if they exist, then they have an excuse with Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Allah went, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. And we will never punish a people until we send to them a messenger. So they have an excuse with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Okay. Belief in the prophets and belief in the messengers is one of the fundamental beliefs. One of the fundamental beliefs. If somebody doesn't believe in messengership or prophethood, they're not from the believers, they're not from the Muslims. One of the major issues concerning the prophets and the messengers is, what is the difference between a prophet and a messenger? What is the difference between a prophet and a messenger? Or are they the same? Are they the same? There are many different opinions. What is a messenger, what is a prophet, and what is the difference between them? The main opinions, I'll give you main two opinions, is that a prophet A prophet is the one who is conveyed, the one who Allah reveals revelation to. However, he's not ordered to convey the message. A prophet is one who is revealed to, Allah reveals revelation to him. However, he's not commanded to convey that message. Whereas a prophet, a messenger, is the one who is revealed to, a revelation comes to him, and he's ordered to convey it to the people. This is a major opinion of the scholars. However, it doesn't agree with many of the ayat of the Quran, where Allah talks about the prophets and how they conveyed the messages. So there's verses of the Quran which seem to negate this opinion, that they were, the messages were sent and they were ordered to convey. So another opinion which seems to be more correct is that a prophet is one who reveals, who receives revelation and is sent to a people, but he's not given a new law. So he receives revelation. He's ordered to convey the revelation, but he's not given a new law to implement on the people that he's sent to. He's not given a new law. The law remains the law of the prophet or the messenger before him. And we see this apparent in Bani Israel. They had many prophets and some messengers. The law of Musa remained within Bani Israel for a long period of time until Isa alayhi salam came. But between Musa and Isa there were other prophets. Dawood and Sulaiman. They were prophets and not messengers. They were sent, they were given revelation. They conveyed the revelation to their people. But their law was the law of Musa. Their law was the law of Musa. They didn't come with any new law. Isa came and he said, I've been sent with a revelation and a new law for you. يُحِلَّ لَكُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي حُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ. I've been sent that I may make halal upon you some of that which was haram upon you. So I've got a new law for you. So he was a messenger. And this seems to be the most correct opinion, because this goes with all of the verses and the ahadith. The Prophet ﷺ, when he was sent, the scholars say he became a Nabi and then he became a Rasul. He became a Nabi and then he became a Rasul. And there was a time between these two. Before he became a Rasul, there was a time when he was just a Nabi. And they say he became a Nabi with the first revelation, Iqra. And he became a Rasul with the verses of Surah Al-Mudathir, when Allah said, قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ, when Allah orders him to stand and convey. So from this they say that it's possible that a messenger, a prophet, at some time doesn't convey the message that is sent to him until he is ordered to it. So it's possible that there is a time where a messenger, confusing the two terms, where a Nabi, let's stick with the Arabic, where a Nabi is given revelation but is not told to convey that revelation at that time. And later on he will be told to convey the revelation. So between these two surahs, the Prophet ﷺ became a Nabi but he wasn't told to convey the message. He was told to learn about Allah Azza wa Jal. Then he was told to worship Allah Azza wa Jal and become connected to Allah Azza wa Jal. And once that had occurred, then he was told to stand up and call the people to the Tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal. Is that understood? The people of Quraysh, before the Prophet ﷺ was sent to them, what religion were they supposed to be upon? What religion, what deen were they supposed to, what millah were they supposed to be upon? The millah of Ibrahim. The millah of Ibrahim. Again, Ismail alayhi salam was the son of Ibrahim. The millah, Allah always tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ittabi' millata Ibrahim. Because Ibrahim was the one who reached the pinnacle of tawhid, of worship of Allah, from very few worship Allah in the most human, perfect way, if you can say that. The best way that Allah can be worshipped was done by Ibrahim alayhi salam and by our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why Allah ta'ala constantly tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اِتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. Follow the way of Ibrahim. And the Quraysh regarded themselves being upon the millah of Ibrahim. And they were supposed to follow the way of Ibrahim. However, they went away from the way of Ibrahim. And they worshipped the idols. And they committed shirk with Allah, so Allah sent them the final messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and began the call with them to bring them back to the millah of Ibrahim. And with that he gave a new sharia. Ibrahim had a sharia. What meaning of sharia is the law. The law of Ibrahim, we don't know what the law of Ibrahim was. There are parts of the law that we know, which agrees with the laws of Torah. But the law of Ibrahim in totality, we don't know what the law of Ibrahim was. And we know Ibrahim alayhi salam was sent a book as well. Suhuf Ibrahim. The suhuf are books. Ibrahim was given books. But we don't know what that law was. And we don't know what those books were. The Prophet ﷺ came to call the people back to millat of Ibrahim, but he was given a new law. And this law was to supersede every other law that come before. Muhaiminan alayhi, to take over every law and to be established until the day of judgment. No other law will be accepted in the sight of Allah than the law of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every other law has been wiped out. If a Muslim, or somebody who claims to be Muslim, comes and says he wants to establish the law of the Torah, or he wants to establish the law of the Injil, or he says, I want to establish the law of Ibrahim, would that be acceptable for him to do? Would that be acceptable for him to do? No. Rather, by doing that, he would become a kafir, he would become a disbeliever. He would leave the fold of Islam. Because the only law which is acceptable from the time of the Prophet ﷺ until Yawm al-Qiyamah in the sight of Allah is the law of the Prophet ﷺ. No other law is acceptable. Then the Shaykh, the Imam, moves on. He says, ثُمَّ خَتَمَ الرِّسَالَةَ وَالنَّظَارَ وَالنُّبُوَّةَ بِمُحَمَّدٍ نَبِيِّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم فَجَعَلَهُ آخِرَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا وَدَاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ بِإِذْنِهِ وَسِرَاجًا مُنِيرًا وأنزل عليه كتابه الحكيم كتابه الحكيم وشرح به دينه القويم وهدى به الصراط المستقيم. All of this is explaining who the Prophet ﷺ is. So the Imam says, then he completed, or he finished, or he sealed the messages and the warning with the prophethood of our Messenger ﷺ. He was the final of all prophets and the final of all messengers. There is no messenger or no prophet to come after him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. With him, all of messengership and prophethood is finished. فَجَعْلَهُ آخِرَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ He made him the final of the messengers, بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا giving glad tidings and warning, وَدَّاعِيًا إِلَى اللَّهِ and calling to Allah بِإِذْنِهِ with his permission. And he made him a glowing light. In this darkness, he made him a glowing light. وَأَنْزَلَ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابَ الْحَكِيمِ And he revealed upon him the wise book, Al-Qur'an, of course. وَشَرَحَ بِهِ دِينَهُ الْقَوِيمِ And through the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah explained and made clear the straight religion, his straight religion, his noble religion. وَهَدَى بِهِ صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ And through him, Allah guided mankind to the straight path. The Prophet ﷺ once was sitting with the companions and he had a stick in his hand and he drew a line in the sand and he said, هَذَا صِرَاطُ اللَّهِ مُسْتَقِيمٌ This is the path of Allah, the straight path. And then he drew lines to its right and to its left. And he said that these are other paths. Upon the head of each path is a shaitan calling to it. Whoever chooses or listens to those and follows their path will fall into the fire of hell. The path to Allah is one path. It's the straight path, but it's the long path. As we see in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ drew a line, a straight line, and the line was long. And then he drew other lines which were shorter, and they were crooked. And they came off this path. They weren't separate from this path. They started at this path and they went off from this path. And those lines, they had people calling them, calling to them. And in some narrations, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned who these people were, are, who called to these crooked paths. He said, they are from us. They are from us. They have our skin. They speak our language. But their hearts are the hearts of devils. Their hearts are the hearts of the devils. They have eloquence in one narration. They have eloquence in their speech. And they misguide the people. And they take them away from the path of Allah. But the path of Allah is straight. The path of Allah is long. And the path of Allah is hard. There's no shortcuts. There's no shortcuts. The path of Allah is long and hard. But in the end, you end up in Jannah. In the end, you end up in Jannah. The paths of shaitan are short. And they're easy. And they're full of what you desire. And they're easy to follow. But they will take you away from the path of Allah. Allah says, وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِ مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوا وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِ Allah says that this is my path, so follow it. And do not follow the other paths. That they may, these other paths will, they will take you away from my path. The path of Allah is long. The path of Allah is hard. Look at the Prophet ﷺ. He did from the moment he said, Allah said to him, قُمْ فَأَنْذِرْ He didn't get any rest after that. After that, he didn't relax. He didn't have any ease in his life. After Allah said to him, قُمْ فَأَنْذِرْ His life became hard. His life became difficult. Look at the companions of radiallahu anhum from the moment they entered Islam. Before Islam, their life was easy. Their life was simple. Play and enjoyment. Doing whatever they pleased. No one to question them. But when they entered into Islam, their life became difficult. Their life became hard. They didn't have the ease. When does the believer rest? When does the believer have ease? When does the believer relax? When?
After they died.
When they put their first foot in Jannah. When you put your foot in Jannah, then you can relax. Before then, there is no relaxing. Before then, there is difficulty and hardship. There's having to have patience. Patience upon the commands of Allah. Patience upon staying away from what Allah has prohibited. Patience upon the qadr of Allah. Patience upon hardships and difficulty. The believer doesn't rest until he puts his first foot in Jannah. That's when you rest. It's reported that Imam Ahmad, on his deathbed, when he was dying, he kept coming in and out of consciousness. And when he came out of when he came into consciousness, he was heard saying "La ba'd, la ba'd, la ba'd," and then he would become unconscious again. And then he'd wake up again, and again he would say "La ba'd, la ba'd, la ba'd." What does it mean? Not yet, not yet. So he kept saying "Not yet." And the people around him couldn't understand. What does he mean, not yet? What is this not yet? So at one time when he became conscious, they asked him, "Oh Imam, you keep saying La Ba'd. What is this?" He says, "At my foot is Shaytan. At my feet is Shaytan." And he's saying to me, "Oh Ahmed, you have escaped me. Oh Ahmed, you have escaped me." And I'm saying to him, "Not yet. While the breath, while the soul is still in my body, you can still take me. Until the breath leaves and I can enter Jannah, then I'll escape." So while we are living, our life is difficult. It's not bed of roses. And no one should expect it to be. Allah tests His slaves. He tests the prophets. He tested the messengers. He tested the companions. Do we think we will be left alone? So Allah, here the Imam is quite apparent what he's saying. He's saying to us that the Prophet ﷺ is the final messenger and the final prophet. No one will be sent after him. Anybody who claims to be a prophet or a messenger after him, then his claim is null and void. Because we know the Prophet ﷺ is the last. None cannot come after him. But Allah will send, as it's reported, Al-Mahdi. And Allah will send Isa ibn Maryam. But Al-Mahdi is not a prophet, and he's not a messenger. What is Al-Mahdi? Al-Mahdi is a righteous ruler that Allah will send towards the end of time. And I assume that Imam will mention him, that he will send Al-Mahdi towards the end of time. The Prophet ﷺ said, when the earth is full of injustice, when the earth is full of injustice, he will come and fill it with justice. When the earth is totally, according to the hadith, when the earth is totally full of injustice, and you can't see the justice anywhere, then Allah will send Al-Mahdi. And he will come and fill it with justice. And he will reign for 7 years, according to the majority. And he will be a righteous ruler. As for Isa ibn Maryam, then Isa ibn Maryam is a messenger. He was a messenger sent before the Prophet ﷺ. There's no messenger between the Prophet Isa ﷺ and the Prophet ﷺ. There is no messenger between the two of them. He was taken up into the heavens and he was not crucified. As we know this belief of the Muslims. He was not crucified. He was taken up, raised into the heavens. And he is from إِنَّهُ لَعَلَمٌ لِلسَّاعِ. Allah says إِنَّهُ لَعِلْمٌ لِلسَّاعِ in the recitation of Hafs. إِنَّهُ لَعِلْمٌ لِلسَّاعِ. This is one way, and it is the knowledge of the hour, or he is from the knowledge of the hour. And in the majority recitation of the Quran, إِنَّهُ لَعَلَمٌ لِلسَّاعَةِ. He is, talking about Isa ibn Maryam, he is a sign of the hour. Isa ibn Maryam is a sign of the hour. So he, as he was already a prophet and he was already a messenger, this is still fulfills that the Prophet ﷺ is the last and final messenger. And his religion will remain until the end of time. And no religion will be accepted after him ﷺ. No new religion will be accepted. And this deen will last until the last day. And in the last days, everybody will enter into this deen. As is reported in many of the narrations, when Isa ibn Maryam comes and he destroys, he breaks the cross and kills the pigs, and he abolishes jizya. He abolishes jizya. What's jizya? The tax. What tax? We pay tax. Yes. Is this jizya? I hope it's not jizya. What's jizya? The tax the disbelievers, Jews and the Christians, who live amongst the Muslims and live under the protection of the Muslims, pay to the Muslims. This is jizya. And what that means is they're part of the Islamic country or the Islamic state, and they come under the protection of the Muslims. So if anybody attacks them, the Muslims will defend them as long as they pay this jizya. Okay, that's what it means, the jizya. Now there's no jizya. There's no jizya. But when Isa ibn Maryam comes, he will abolish jizya, which indicates that before his time there will be jizya. Yes? For him to abolish jizya, there will have to have been jizya, which indicates that there will be Muslim rulers ruling according to the Sharia. There will be, the Khilafah will be established. For there to be a jizya, you need a Khilafah. All of these indicate to us that before the coming of Isa ibn Maryam, the Muslims will be ruling. And the disbelievers, the Jews and the Christians, will be under the rulership of the Muslims. And this is not what I'm saying. This is what the Prophet ﷺ is telling us. And then Isa ibn Maryam will come as a sign of the final day. And he will break the cross. And he will, breaking the cross means he will destroy Christianity. Because they will know he is Isa ibn Maryam. And he will kill the swine. And he will abolish the jizya. And the scholars say abolishing the jizya here means that everyone will enter into Islam. And there will only be one religion. And it will be Al-Islam. But those who enter Islam at that time, the Islam would not be accepted from them by Allah Azza wa Jalla, because they entered it after Tawbah is now over. The doors of Tawbah have been closed, and Allah knows best. Then the Imam moves on and he says, وَأَنَّ السَّاعَةَ آتِيَةٌ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَبْعَثُ مَنْ يَمُوتُ كَمَا بَدَعَهُمْ يَعُودُونَ. Then he moves on to belief in the last day. And he says, verily the hour will come, and there is no doubt about the hour. And Allah will resurrect all of those who die. And he will bring them back like he created them in the first creation. وَأَنَّ السَّاعَةَ آتِيَةٌ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهَا. Allah mentioned this in many places in the Qur'an. That the hour will come. It will come all of a sudden. People will not be expecting it and it will come. La rayba fiha. There is no doubt in its coming. There is no doubt in its coming. It will come. Mankind will be in a state of ghafla, heedlessness of this hour, and it will come all of a sudden upon mankind. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned that it will come on a Friday. It will come on a Friday. And in some narrations, the Prophet ﷺ said every Friday, the animals are afraid every Friday night, meaning every Thursday night. The night of Friday, as we know in Islamic terms, the night precedes the day. That's why we have the Salah in Ramadan the Salah al-Taraweeh begins before the day we fast. Yes? Because that's the night, the first night of Ramadan. And the day comes after it. So the night comes and the day comes. So the night of Friday is actually the night of Thursday, yes? So during the night of Thursday, let's use the night of Thursday, the animals are afraid, the animals. And they are scared and they are frightened and they wait in this fear and in this terror that perhaps the morning will be the day of judgment. And they're only relieved when judgment doesn't come. They're only relieved when judgment doesn't come. Except for two, jinn and man. The only two who are not afraid. The only two that are heedless, who don't have any care that it's Thursday night and Friday could be their judgment, is jinn and man. The ones who have to give account. The animals, what account are they going to give? No. They're going to be turned to dust. But we will have to give account. And then, إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَإِلَى النَّارِ. And man and jinn are heedless of that night. And they don't take any notice that tomorrow is Juwan, or in the morning is Juwan. And the day of judgment is upon a Friday. There is no doubt that this day will come and Allah will resurrect mankind. The timing, when is the day of judgment? When is the day of judgment? Prophet ﷺ was asked this in the hadith of Jibreel. Yes? Right at the end. Jibreel said to the Prophet ﷺ, Mata sa'a. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Mata sa'a, when is the hour? And the Prophet ﷺ responded, the one who is being questioned does not know more than the one who is questioning. We are equal in its knowledge. Neither of us know it. We are equal in its knowledge. لا يعلمها إلا الله. None knows when it will come except Allah. The Prophet ﷺ said, مفاتيح الغيب خمسة or خمس, that the keys of the unseen are five. Five things that only Allah alone knows. لا يعلمها إلا الله. لا يعلمها إلا الله. And from them is when is the day of judgment. When is the day of judgment? When exactly will it occur? And it's from Allah's mercy that we don't know. It's from Allah's mercy that we don't know when we will die. It's from Allah's mercy that we don't know when the day of judgment is. What would happen if you knew when you would die?
You would remain in the masjid.
You would remain in the masjid? What would you be like? From the moment you were born, you had like a watch on your arm, and it tells you your time. When you're going to die, what would that be like?
It's
impossible to happen. Yes, it can't happen. You wouldn't be able to do anything. You wouldn't be able to move. It would be a state of despair constant. You know, people who get cancer and things like that, and the doctors say you have such and such time to live. Ask them how their life is when they're told this, and there's nothing we can do. Ask them how their life becomes, especially if they're not believers, if they're not Muslims. Ask them how their life becomes. It's a life of despair when you know. We all know we're going to die, yes? There's no one on the planet that thinks that they're going to live forever. But it's from Allah's mercy that we don't know exactly when we're going to die. Otherwise we wouldn't be able to get up in the morning. We wouldn't be able to do anything. This is the mercy of Allah that He kept this secret from us. And from the mercy of Allah is that we don't know in Jahannam when Al-Qiyamah will happen. If we knew when Al-Qiyamah would happen, we wouldn't be able to do anything either. we'll be in a state of despair constantly. These are from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, that He hides these things from us. Also from the mercy of Allah is Allah's Qadr, that is hidden from us. Especially the bad things of Qadr. If you knew the things, the calamities that were going to befall you, how would your life be? How would your life be if you knew the calamities that were going to come and befall you, before they came, how would your life be? You wouldn't be able to live. These are from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, that He hides these things from us. May Allah save us. The sa'ah is of two types, sa'at al-kubra wa sa'at al-sughra. The hour, when Allah mentions that al-sa'ah, scholars make it into two, sa'at al-sughra and sa'at al-kubra. Sa'at al-sughra, the smaller hour, is the day a person dies. That's called sa'at al-sughra. And sa'at al-kubra is the day of judgment itself. When a person dies, he comes to Sa'at al-Sughra, but he's entered the path to Sa'at al-Kubra. He's towards, it's the beginning of the Akhirah. Death is the first stage to the Akhirah. If what comes after death is good, then everything after it will be good. And if what comes after death is bad, then everything after it will be worse. It's reported that Uthman radiallahu anhu used to stand at a grave after somebody had been buried and would cry until his beard would become wet. And some of the companions or some of the tabi'in would ask him, why? Why do you do this? This person was a believer and he's gone to the mercy of Allah. And Uthman would say, I do this to remind myself that the grave is either a garden from the gardens of paradise or a ditch from the ditch of Jahannam. If it is a garden from the gardens of paradise, then everything after it will be easy. Everything after it will be easy. But if it's a ditch from the ditch of Jahannam, then everything after will be more difficult. Everything after will be more difficult. The grave, the punishment of the grave itself is enough. Is enough. But the akhirah is worse for the one who's punished in the grave. And the blessings of the grave, the bounty of the grave, is enough. But Jannah is far greater. It's a first, it's a stepping stone to the Akhirah. Yes.
If at that point that you know that what will happen to you is either good or bad, then the day of judgment is where? What will you be judged on? I already know where you're going to go.
Yeah, you know where you're going.
But the judgment day.
But the judgment will happen in front of everyone. You'll be judged in front of the whole of creation.
Yeah, but by that time you should know, would you know that you're already okay?
You would know in the grave that you are okay, that you are going to judgment, yes.
But
you
on the day of judgment,
but on the day of judgment you would be terrified again.
Okay.
Again, you would be terrified. You know that you're going to judgment. Okay. Yeah? But again, because of the harshness, the difficulty of that day, you will be scared that even what you know is not true. Even though what you were sure of may not occur because of the terror of that day. Allah mentions the terror of that day. When the earth quakes and the people run around as if they're drunk and anything carrying something will let go of what it's carrying. Like, it mentions the camel, who is pregnant, will let go of it, whatever is inside it, out of the terror of that day. Can't imagine the terror of that day. The child, the fetus, as it mentions, will come and its hair will turn white out of fear of that day. Everything will change that day. We will not recognize anything of this earth that day. Allah will change it. And you will see the whole of humanity and the whole of creation standing in one place. Tomorrow is Yawm al-Arafah. Yes? Tomorrow is Yawm al-Arafah. And I'm sure most of you have satellite TV and you will watch people going to the plains of Arafah. And you will see the vast numbers of people standing on Arafah. That's nothing compared to the Day of Judgment. That's nothing. That's minuscule compared to the Day of Judgment. Imagine all of the people that have gone before us, have died before us. To Adam alayhi salam, centuries of people. Can't even imagine how many centuries of people. And imagine all the people to the Day of Judgment. I can't even imagine those people gathered in one place. Gathered in one place. Naked, barefoot, uncircumcised. كَمَا بَدَعْنَا أَوَّلَ خَلْقٍ يُعِيدُ. How we started the first creation, we will return it. That's how you enter this dunya. Anybody enter with clothes? Anybody enter this dunya with clothes? No? Anybody enter this dunya with shoes? Anybody enter this dunya uncircumcised? كَمَا بَدَعْنَا أَوَّلَ خَلْقٍ نُعِيدُ. The way we started creation is the way we will return it, we will resurrect it. Exactly how you enter this dunya. And they will stand together, one place. And men and women together. And we know that Aisha said to Prophet ﷺ, O Messenger of Allah, how? Men and women together, how? And the Prophet said, Ya Aisha, people won't be thinking of that day. The terror will be so much that their eyes will be fixed to the heavens. They won't care who's next to them. They will have no care. Their eyes will be fixed to the heavens, waiting for Allah to come and to start the resurrection, start the account. How will the resurrection take place? Brother comes and get worried.
Yes.
How will the resurrection take place? The resurrection, Prophet ﷺ mentioned that there will be two blowings of the horn. The first, some scholars add a third blowing. But the most correct, wallahu a'lam, is that there will be two blowings of the horn. The first blowing will be that everything alive will come to an end, will die. Prophet ﷺ said that the angel who will blow the trumpet already has the trumpet to his mouth. Already, at the time of Prophet ﷺ, has the trumpet to his mouth. And his eyes are fixed to the throne of Allah, waiting for the command. Just waiting. That's his job. With the trumpet to his mouth, looking. When's the command going to come? This is 1400 years ago. Prophet mentioned. He's looking at the situation for Allah's command. When Allah's command comes, he'll blow the trumpet. The first blowing, everything in the heavens and the earth will come to him, will die. Man will die, animals will die, the insects, everything will come to an end. The majority of the ulama say even the angels will die. The majority of the ulama say even the angels will die. Even the angel of death will die. Even the angel of death will die. Nothing will remain except Allah Azza wa Jalla. And this is what Allah has mentioned. That day He will call out, لمن الملك اليوم, that day he will call out, to whom belongs al-mulk, the dominion, the kingdom, that day, لمن الملك اليوم, today, to who it does it belong? And there is no one to answer Allah Azza wa Jal. Because everything has come to an end. So Allah will answer Himself and say, Lillah, to Allah, Al-Wahid, the One, Al-Qahhar, the Dominant. Because He is the only one left. And He is the Dominant One after everything has perished. Kullu shayin halik illa wajhu. Everything will perish, will come to an end, except His face, Jalla wa Ala. Can you imagine the silence of that day when that happens? There is nothing. Everything has come to a finish. All things that were living are now dead. And the only one living is Al-Hayy Alladhi La Yamut, is the Hayy, Allah Azza wa Jal, the living who will never die. Can you imagine the silence of that day? And then Allah calls out, لِمَنْ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ, to whom belongs the kingdom that day, today. Where's all the kings and the presidents and the prime ministers and those who thought they were something? Nothing, in reality. Then Allah will call, answer Himself, لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ, to Allah, the One, the only One, the Dominant. Then Allah will tell, then Allah will bring back the angel of the trumpet and tell him to blow the trumpet, the second blowing of the trumpet. And the creation, the resurrection will begin after the second blowing. Prophet ﷺ mentioned in some of the narrations that Allah will send down a rain like the semen of the man. And this will cause the bodies to become resurrected. They will join back. They will join. The only thing that of the man that doesn't decay is the small, the back part of the backbone, right at the back. There's a small, the size of a mustard seed. That's all that will remain of man. That's all that will remain. Everything else will decay, except for the bodies of the Anbiya. As the Prophet ﷺ told us, the bodies of the Prophets and the Messengers, they don't decay, they remain as they were. And some scholars say the bodies of the Shuhada as well. But there's no proof, textual proof, from the Quran and the Hadith to say that the bodies of the Mujahideen stay. But it's something that the people have found. It's something that the people have found. After centuries when they removed bodies of Shuhada, they found them still with the blood coming out of where they were hurt or where they died from. But there's no textual proof, there's no ayah or hadith that says the bodies of the Mujahideen remain. The textual proof is that the bodies of the Anbiya are not eaten by the earth. Everybody else's body will decay. This body that you think is whatever you think of your body, it will turn to dust. It will be eaten by the insects of the earth. The body that you think is something, the insects will eat it and bring it up. Bacteria that you can't even see, that you don't even think of, will take your body and turn it to nothing. That's what we are. One man, once, one of the, I think it was Fudayl ibn Iyad, was asked, he was talking to somebody and the man said, don't you, he was talking to a Khalifa. And the Khalifa said, don't you know who I am? And he said to him, yes, I know exactly who you are. He said to him, you are Nutfatun Qadira. You are, your origin is a drop of semen that nobody has any like for. Qadir is something you don't even think of. And your end, wa akhiratuka jifatun, and your end is a rotting body. And between that, you carry feces in your stomach constantly. That's what you are. That's what you are. That's your reality. Don't think you are something. The body will rot, and the only thing that will remain is that small part of the person. And from that, Allah will resurrect the person. From that small piece, Allah will resurrect the person and bring them back. And that is easy upon Allah. Allah says He will bring you back even your fingertips. Even your fingertips. Why does He mention the fingertips? Important mentioning of al-banan, the banan. Not the bananas we eat. Banan. Why does He mention the fingertips? Even the fingertips will bring them back.
Huh?
Because they're unique, each person has a specific to themselves. Your fingers won't be joined upon, your hand won't be joined upon somebody else. No, everything of yours will be given to you. And that's something easy upon Allah. وَمَا خَلْقُكُمْ وَلَا بَعْثُكُمْ إِلَّا كَنَفْسٍ وَاحِدًا. Allah said that your creation and your resurrection is like that of one person. And that is easy upon Allah.
Those Hindus are buried.
They're not buried, they're burnt.
They're burnt, they said they're burnt.
Yes.
Who is angry, chances?
Of course. So it's like easy upon Allah. Even when a person is burnt, there are things, there are, that thing remains in their ashes, it remains. And no matter, they will scatter themselves. They scatter themselves wherever they scatter themselves. But it's easy upon Allah to bring every piece of them back. Easy upon Allah. Look at the creations of heaven and the earth. How difficult is that? And that is easy upon Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah tells you from proofs that Allah gives of the resurrection. Proofs Allah gives of the resurrection is, He says, لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ. That the creation of the heavens and the earth is greater and more difficult in the creation of a small human being. But that creation didn't tire Allah, didn't take anything away from Allah, was simple for Allah Azza wa Jalla, was with one word, kun, and it came into existence. So what do you think you are? The mountains are more difficult in creation than you are. But that's easy upon Allah, the heaven, the sky. Allah mentions all of these things, that we created all of these things, and how do you think we cannot bring you back into existence? And Allah uses another proof, the proof of the earth when it's dead. When the earth has become barren, and there's no vegetation upon it, nothing's growing upon it. And then Allah sends down some small rain, and how the it sprouts out and comes back to life. That's easy upon Allah. What are you? It's easy upon Allah Azza wa Jalla. The power of Allah, no one can imagine the power of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Okay, then the Imam moves on. He spoke about the Day of Judgment. He says, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى ضَاعَفَ عِبَادِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ لَحَسَنَاتِ وَصَفَحَ لَهُمُ بِالتَّوْبَةِ عَنْ كَبَائِرِ السَّيِّئَاتِ وَغَفَرَ لَهُمُ الصَّغَائِرِ بِاجْتِنَابِ الْكَبَائِرِ وَجَعَلَ مَنْ لَمْ يَتُبْ مِنَ الْكَبَائِرِ صَائِرًا إِلَى مَشِيئَتِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. That Allah Ta'ala increases the reward of an action for the believers. One, He doesn't just leave it as one reward. And a believer does an action, Allah will increase it, multiply it, give him more than what he deserves. From 10 to 700 to even more than that. Allah, through His mercy, through His karam, He gives more, He multiplies the reward of the believer. وَصَفَحَ لَهُمْ بِالتَّوْبَةِ عَنْ كَبَائِ السَّيِّئَاتِ. And he wipes out with tawbah their grave sins. The grave, kabair, the grave sins, the major sins. Just with that small tawbah, he wipes them out. As if they were not, they never had been. As if they had never been, he wipes them out. وَغَفَرَ لَهُمُ الصَّغَائِرُ. And he forgives for them the small sins, the minor sins. بِجْتِنَابِ الْكَبَائِرُ. By them staying away from the major sins. So, the small sins, the minor sins are wiped out, are forgiven automatically if one stays away from the major sins. What is a major sin and what is a minor sin? What is a major sin and what is a minor sin? A major sin is a sin which Allah has mentioned for it a punishment. Or has mentioned that in the hereafter, they will, either in the dunya there will be a punishment, or in the hereafter there is fire. That's a major sin. Like stealing. Allah has mentioned no punishment in the Akhirah for it. But He mentioned a punishment in this dunya for it. What's the punishment of stealing according to the Sharia? For the one who steals more than a certain amount, 4 dirham, or 4 dinar, then his hand is chopped off. And he steals it from a place, a safe, something where it's been locked and guarded, not something that is open. These conditions have to be met. The stealing has to occur from something which is locked away, something which is guarded, and something which is worth more than 4 dinar. If something is worth less than 4 dinar and it's guarded, the person's hand is not chopped off. If something is worth millions, but it was left lying without any guarding and protection, and it was taken, the person's hand is not chopped off. The only time a person's hand is chopped off is when it's worth more than 4 dinar and it's guarded and locked away. And then the person steals it. When these conditions are met and it's proven that the person did it, then the person's hand is chopped off. Okay? If somebody went to like a store or something, and as they're walking by, stole something from the store, would their hand be chopped, or they were caught, would their hand be chopped off for that?
No.
Even if the shopkeeper reports it. Because it's laid out. It's not guarded. It's still stealing. I'm not saying it's not stealing. But the Sharia puts conditions upon what stealing leads to the cutting of a hand, which is a big thing. Losing your hand is not something simple. Not what the kuffar make it out. Steal a chocolate bar, something will straight away chop your hand off right there and then. No, it's not like Sharia makes it. Sharia puts these punishments there, not for them to be established, but for them to be deterrents. You know, like the nuclear deterrent. You heard about the nuclear deterrent? No? Every country tries to get a nuclear bomb. Why? Because the other countries have a nuclear bomb. So if I have a nuclear bomb and they have a nuclear bomb, and we both know we each other have a nuclear bomb, we're not going to use it. I'm going to deter somebody attacking me with their nuclear bomb by having a nuclear bomb. It's to deter, not to use. Yes? Perhaps there are some mad people who will use it. Sharia does the same thing. It puts these punishments, harsh punishments. Not that it wants the punishment to be fulfilled. It doesn't. Many times it doesn't want the punishment to be fulfilled. How difficult is it for you to be punished, have your hand chopped off? You have to steal a certain amount, and it has to be in a place which is locked and guarded, and there has to be proof, and there has to be no doubt Even 1% of doubt, you can't chop off the hand. Same as zina or adultery. What's the punishment for adultery? I know we're off the topic now. What's the punishment of adultery? Stoning to death. Adultery is when somebody's married. Fornication is when somebody's not married. So adultery is a very harsh punishment. Why? Because why is adultery more harsh than fornication? Fornication, the punishment is whipping, lashes, 100 lashes. Why is it more harsh? Because the one who commits fornication doesn't know, doesn't have a way of fulfilling his desires. So it's easier for him or her to fall into the sin. Yes? Somebody who doesn't have a way, a halal way of fulfilling his desires, it's easier for that person to fall into sin. But the one who has a halal way and then chooses haram, he's not equal to the one who doesn't have a halal way. So the punishment for that person is worse. Because if he wanted to fulfill his desires, he had it, has it in front of him. So the punishment for adultery is stoning to death. When is a person stoned to death? What are the conditions? There has to be 4 witnesses. Okay? And they have to see the action. What action? The male organ entering the female organ. They have to see that. They have to see the male organ disappear into the female organ. When will that happen? They have to stand there and watch. For the witnesses to be accepted. And if it's proven that they just saw something, they saw a man on top of a woman and they were naked, they will be lashed. 80 lashes. The Sharia doesn't want it to be established. The Sharia wants to deter you from doing the sin. The only time that somebody has been stoned to death is when they confess. That's the only time it's happened. The law has been established. When they confess to the sin. When Ma'is and Al-Ghamidiyya came to the Prophet ﷺ. Ma'iz came once and Al-Ghamidiyya, who is a woman, came to the Prophet ﷺ. When Ma'iz came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, "O Messenger of Allah, قَدْ زَنَيْتْ, I committed adultery." The Prophet ﷺ, when he first said it, he turned away from him, as if he didn't hear him. And then Ma'iz went to the other side and said, "O Messenger of Allah, I've committed adultery." The Prophet ﷺ said, "Perhaps you touched him." But I said, "No, O Messenger of Allah, Zanait." He said, "Perhaps you kissed her. Perhaps, perhaps, perhaps." Until he said to him, there was no excuse, and the Prophet ﷺ had to establish the ruling upon him. And he was stoned to death. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "If you're throwing the stones at him and he runs away, let him go. Don't follow him. Perhaps he will repent and Allah will repent upon him. Let him go." The Sharia doesn't want these things to be established. They're there to deter the people from doing them. Al-Ghamidiyya, same thing. She came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, "I've committed adultery." And the Prophet ﷺ still didn't want to establish it. And then she said, "And I'm pregnant from that adultery." The Prophet ﷺ said to her, "Okay, go 9 months until you give birth, and then come back to me." She went and gave birth, and then she came back to the Prophet ﷺ and said, and he asked her again, "Are you sure?" She said, "Yes, O Messenger of Allah, I want Allah to purify me. I want Allah to purify me." So the Prophet ﷺ said to her, "Go back and breastfeed your child 2 years. For 2 years, go back, and then come to me." So she went back, so 9 months. After she's committed adultery. 9 months, and then another 2 years. 2 years and 9 months. The Prophet ﷺ didn't establish the ruling. And then only after that time, the Prophet ﷺ had her stoned to death. And only because she wanted Allah to purify her. If she hadn't, the scholars say, if she hadn't come back to the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ wouldn't have sent anybody after her. he would have left the issue between her and Allah Azza wa Jalla. The laws, these laws are there to deter the people. If somebody comes and it happens and if everything is proved, then the law must be established. But if there's any way of not establishing it, the Sharia will look for a way of not establishing it. The Sharia doesn't want blood. They make it out that we want blood. For everything we want blood. For every little thing we want blood. No, Sharia doesn't want your blood. Every excuse will be given to you. Okay, so that was a major sin. I'm going to stop in a few minutes, inshallah. These were the major sins, that which either have a punishment in this dunya or they have a punishment in the akhirah. As for a minor sin, then it is any sin where Allah hasn't mentioned a punishment in the dunya or in the akhirah. Yes,
please. Quickly, the major sins you say obviously are forgiven with repentance, but there's got to be conditions under what you will repent. You can't simply say, oh, I repent and that's it, it's all done.
No. Repentance has three conditions. First condition of repentance is feeling remorse. Actually feeling the remorse and regret over what you have done. Second is calling upon Allah Azza wa Jalla and asking His forgiveness. And the third is to really sincerely say to yourself and make it a promise with yourself and with Allah that you will not return to that sin. That you will do everything not to return to that sin. And at that moment you have to be truthful in that you will not return to that sin. Not that you're faking it, but as soon as it's over I'm going to try it again. No. Sincere repentance is that you feel regret and remorse for what you have done. And you repent to Allah Azza wa Jal and you sincerely make that promise with yourself and with Allah that you will not return. If you do that sincerely and then you do return to the sin, you repent again in the same way. And Allah will forgive you every time. This is Tawwab al-Rahim. Yes.
Sorry, just on that point again. There are people who commit sins thinking, oh well, I'll repent and I'll be okay. I suppose that's not found people.
You know the answer to that. I'll do the sin, I'll repent later.
Yeah, people do that.
If somebody does that, somebody says, I'm going to do the sin, and he does the sin, and then in his mind is going to repent after. And that's his normal status. He does the sin and repents. Then that would not be forgivable, and that would not be repentance. But if somebody said that to themselves, and then when he came to repentance, he actually sincerely repented. He didn't have that in his mind, but when he came to it, once he had done it, he felt the guilt of the sin, and the remorse of the sin, and then he sincerely repented to Allah. And then he promised to Allah that he wouldn't return, then Allah will forgive him. None forgives like Allah Azza wa Jalla. Ya ibadi. Allah says, oh my slaves, no matter what sins you've done, if you come to me repenting, Allah, I will forgive you. Ya ibadi alladhina asrafu ala anfusih. La taqnatu min rahmatillah. Oh my slaves who have wronged your own souls. Do not despair in the mercy of Allah. La taqnatu min rahmatillah. Never despair in the mercy of Allah. Never. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'a. Allah forgives every single sin, no matter how great they are. Innahu huwa ghafurur rahim. Verily, He is of forgiving, merciful. Allah says in the Hadith Qudsi of Sahih Muslim, if you, O slave of mine, O son of Adam, if you will come to me with the earth full of sins reaching the heavens, and you were to meet me, not committing shirk with me, then I would come to you with an equal amount of forgiveness. This is the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla. You come to Him without shirk, no matter what you've done, He'll come to you with an equal amount of forgiveness. Jalla wa ala. Huwa al-Ghafoor al-Rahim. He loves to forgive His slaves. The Sheikh finishes and says, the one who dies without repenting from the major sins, then he, his issue goes back to the will of Allah. His matter is that he is under the will of Allah. If Allah wills, he will punish him. And if Allah wills, he will forgive him. But we know that there will be people that Allah will punish. There will be people that Allah will enter into the hellfire. There will be people that Allah will enter into the hellfire from the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they will remain in hellfire for a time, and then they will exit it due to their faith, and they will be entered into Jannah. But the person who dies upon a major sin and hasn't repented to Allah, then his matter is that he's under the will of Allah. If Allah wills, he will forgive him. And if Allah wills, he will punish him. But if he's a believer, he will enter paradise. And then the Shaykh finishes saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ. That Allah doesn't forgive shirk, but He forgives every other sin besides shirk. The only sin that Allah will not forgive, if somebody dies upon shirk, if somebody dies upon calling other than Allah, forgiving partners with Allah, Allah, and dies upon that, Allah will not forgive him. But every other sin that a person dies upon, Allah is ready to forgive them, and he is under the mercy, the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah knows best. Is there any questions, or we'll stop there? Yes. Yes, speak loudly.
Is it possible to commit a major sin in ignorance?
Yes, if you commit a major sin in ignorance.
Is that going to be punishable?
Ignorance is an excuse with Allah. If somebody doesn't know that this is a sin and does it thinking that it's not a sin, then his excuse in front of Allah is no idea. As long as he knew that he didn't know it's a sin, some people might try to fool Allah Azza wa Jal. But Allah is not tricked. I didn't know, and he actually knew that it's a major sin. If the person truly didn't know it's a major sin, like some of the companions drank alcohol and they had a ta'weel, some of them didn't receive the news that it was made haram. So they didn't know, so they excused in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's only when the person knows that this is not allowed, and this is a major sin, or this is a sin, and then carries on, then Allah will take into account. And still Allah is ready to forgive them. And Allah knows, we'll stop there.
Okay.